Sir, is there? We can start now.
Yes, you start live streaming.
Yes, sir, I'm starting.
Yeah, and then ask Honey to introduce.
Honey.
Thank you, sir. Sir, it is my immense pleasure and a true honor for me to introduce our esteemed speaker for today, who has been immensely gracious to share with us his valuable time. It is also a very difficult task for me to introduce a man who needs no introduction. But I cannot avoid the temptation of speaking about the alumni of NDT Law College, who is the reason behind the moot trial competitions conducting in NDT Law College since last 14 years. He has also initiated continuous legal education programs through Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa for training lawyers up to 7 years. He is one of the senior lawyers practicing since last 32 years in the various fields such as civil, revenue, land acquisition, criminal, arbitration, consumer, cyber law, convincing, matrimonial law, banking law. He has also been the author of various books, namely Civil Pleadings, Convincing and Drafting, Cross-Examination, CPC Approach to Trial Court, Hindu Succession Act 2005, etc. I would not forget to mention that he has been the Vice Chairman of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa of 2008 to 2009. He has also been the Chairman of Maharashtra and Goa of 2010 and 2011. Our speaker has been instrumental in bringing about the significant developments in academic, practical, and in number of disputes through path-breaking cases. Not only he has ensured time and again that justice should not only be done, but also seen to be done. He is amongst us today to speak about the topic, civil suit concept for newcomers. Please welcome the crowning jewel of legal field, Advocate Jayant Jaibhave. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. I am audible, properly audible.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon to all my dear law students from NBT College and also the other colleges. Also, I welcome my all dear friends who are in a profession, the newcomers of the profession. Basically, lockdown has given us different chances. Some few days back, my son has sent me one video, which was a promotional thought of Shiva Khera, the philosopher from India. And I was impressed. He told that life is full of two things. One is choices and another is compromises. He also said that the choices means a choice in your hand. If you are in a lockdown, how to utilize your time is your choice. So you have many choices. So you can just lie on the bed, take complete rest, be in a lazy mood, at the most watch some movies, eat some good food, increase your weight, have some indigestion, take some medicines, and again sleep and again eat. That can be one of the choices. The another choice is to have these seminars like this, have some interaction of the law on a subject where you are going to create your profession. You can read some good books. You can not only read, but you can interact with others. What is the subject of the law, etc. In this 50 days, 60 days, 80 days, we don't know what is the time exactly. Perhaps if you go on doing this, which activity, you are doing, Professor Saad Bhai and his entire team, that may give you a different gain in a life. Your weight may be reduced because you are doing some energetic work. So your weight may be reduced, but your knowledge will be increased. And therefore, in this particular circumstances now, the question is that which types of choices you want in a life? So Shivu Khera was telling that choosing a choice is your choice. But after choosing the choice will choose your life. And choice will control your life. So choice is one of the great philosophy of the life, which is in your hand. So choose how this lockdown period is to be utilized, because today the world is thinking of surviving. If I will survive after the lockdown and after the corona period, then a new world I will see. And for that new world, how I will facing, that is the only concern in this particular time. So my own personal perception is that having a choice of executing these all activities, which you are doing, is a good choice. And choosing a good choice repeatedly makes the life successful. That's what Shiva Khera says. And choosing a wrong choice repeatedly makes you unsuccessful. So choice is one of the aspects of the life. And therefore, you have chosen a correct choice of having these all deliberations of the thoughts on a different subject. And sincerely, you are not only doing it, but you are actively participating in that. That's very nice and good choice. That will make you successful if you go on repeating this. So go on repeating this. He also speaks about the compromises. Compromises means the expectations are there. And perhaps the expectations are not fulfilled. You are unhappy. You are unsatisfied. But in that particular circumstances, in spite of that unsatisfaction or unhappiness, when the circumstances are thoroughly considered and the reasons for that failure are counted, then you get another right path. So he says that this is a way of developing a compromising mind. Compromising means not making a compromise for your self-respect or to your values or to your hard work. While doing all these things, while doing a hard work, while working on your own values, while keeping your own character, still the failure comes in your life. In that particular process, Shiva Khera says that when you interact yourself and find out the reasons for that failure, the another mode of working on the same issues is available to you. At the most, that can be said to be a compromise, friends. So best luck for this activity, first of all. And as a past student of the NBT Law College, I always have a pride in my mind that this is a premises, this is a college, this is a Gokhale Education Society who has contributed positively not only to the city or to the state or to the country, but to the world. So they are the really a global guides under the leadership of great Dr. Principal, our Dr. M.S. Gosavi sir. So in this particular aspect, this webinar and the topic which I have chosen specifically, because it was asked to me which subject you would like to speak. So I'll say that I will not only introduce the civil suit or civil litigation, but I will introduce to the civil adjudication system. The concept is of an adjudication itself. Because, friends, adjudication is a gift given by the English rulers in this country. There was a judicial system right from the old ancient period. And it was also developed with our own jurisprudence based on the truth. We have seen the historical Ram Rajya which was existing. We also heard about the historical strong jurisprudence coming from Maurya Chanakya. In Maharashtra, we have a great tradition of a justice. The great jurist and the great judge of this soil, of this Maharashtra soil, Ramashastri Prabhune, who has not even bothered to announce a death penalty for the rulers, and has also pronounced that this is the only punishment without any concession. So that sort of impartiality, braveness, is there in this soil. You must have heard about the great judicial principles of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. He has prosecuted his own son by making a complainant. And he has explained that king is not above the law. And what is law? Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj has told to his own son, when son has argued with him, that I am a king, I may be a wrong, but king cannot be a wrong, because a king is the ruler. And then Shivaji Maharaj has told the king, son of the king, Yuvraj, you may be a Yuvraj, but the law is above all. And what is law? He said that law is nothing but a logical rules prepared by four elderly persons having a wisdom of society so as to regulate the peace, tranquility in the society. And therefore, as per his own words in a Marathi, kaida manje char samajatya jantya manshanni kelele samaj shastra anusarche samaj shantatena ani naitiktena chalavnyache sadhe niyam ahet. So that is his words. So in this entire process, the question is that civil adjudication came into picture since British rule. You can see the Civil Procedure Code. It is enacted in 1909. Before that, there were religious law, some Muslim courts based on the Muslim law, some another Qazi courts, some another courts law based on the principles of some king, rulers of that particular area, without having one similarity throughout the country. So 1909, enactment of the Civil Procedure Code brought one unique procedure for entire country. And there come a real adjudication system. This adjudication system is based on two things as far as civil adjudication is concerned. It is based on the principle of pleading. Whatever you want to present, first you plead. What is pleading in a course of the time? I'll explain you. But see, simple means pleading is the written contentions about your own complaint or the reply to the complaint. And therefore, in a civil adjudication, pleading is the best. Now, before civil suit, let us understood that in our jurisprudence, Indian jurisprudence, which types of inquiries we have to face? Are there any different types of inquiries? I will, for simplicity, will say that there are three types of an inquiry. First is an administrative inquiry. A simple thing. You want to go for, you are eligible for the ration card. You want to apply for the ration card. The competent authority will make an inquiry that you are XYZ person and will issue your ration card. Right from that, you are taking a passport. Right from that, you are obtaining any administrative order. For that order of the nature of an administrative order, an order or a function of a competent officer who is in an administration on behalf of a government, that particular, before passing that particular order, a small inquiry is required. That inquiry is called as an administrative inquiry. Then another one is a quasi-judicial inquiry. What is that quasi-judicial? Quasi-judicial means some legal inquiry is involved. You purchase the property. Your name is to be entered on 712 extract. You make an application to the Talati. Talati makes an inquiry that yes, sale deed is done. Seller says that yes, I have done, executed a sale deed. Copy of a sale deed is there. Nobody is objecting. All right. Inquiry is met. Report is written. Mutation entry is passed. Name of previous purchaser A is deleted. And the purchaser of the another purchaser is also entered on the 712 extract. So quasi-judicial inquiry. Many types of these quasi-judicial inquiries are there. I have gone for a simple sort of inquiry. The question of the last inquiry is of a judicial inquiry. The inquiry which is to be conducted before the competent court of law or before an authority having a force of law as a court who is sitting as a function with a procedural backup as a court of the law where matters are adjudicated. It can be civil trial, it can be criminal trial, it can be any other trial which is considered as a judicial proceedings. The inquiry in that particular third category is always said to be the judicial sort of inquiry. So judicial inquiry are of a different types. Out of that, when the dispute relates to a civil adjudication means for deciding certain rights between A party and B party, that adjudication is to be done. That is a sort of a judicial inquiry. So it can be a civil trial. It can be an arbitration proceedings. It can be any other proceeding like a caste verification committee. There you are there. In this, different procedures are right. DRT is there. Many types of the forums are there, tribunals are there, under which different types of law, different forums are available. And for that, whatever the inquiry is to be conducted, ultimately, that inquiry is to be said to be a judicial inquiry. So three types of an inquiry. Administrative inquiry, friends, particularly my young law student friends, should have a concept clear that whenever you are going for the inquiries as a professional in your future career, in that career, you will have to clarify yourself. If you are disputing about a passport, disputes of a passport, which type of inquiry? Yes, it's an administrative type of inquiry. If it is some deciding of the rights and therefore some inquiries conducted, quasi-judicial inquiry. And if you are going to adjudicate rights, then particular type of an inquiry, that is a judicial type of an inquiry. So judicial inquiry is a completely full-fledged inquiry. Quasi-judicial, comparatively, it is a small inquiry than of the judicial inquiry, but still inquiry requires. Still, written complaints, say, documents, proof, evidence requires there. And then administrative type of an inquiry. Administrative type of an inquiry is a short inquiry. But still, the law is settled. In a famous case of Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, when Article 21 was discussed, when the right to travel abroad for Menaka Gandhi was in a question of a dispute. In that particular case of a Menaka Gandhi, it was said that it is an administrative inquiry. In that administrative inquiry, whatever order we have passed, that cannot be said to be an arbitrarily. It's a small inquiry. There also, the Supreme Court has held that it may be an administrative inquiry. Still, you will have to follow the natural principle of justice. So not following the natural principle of justice is not permissible either in an administrative inquiry, and there's no question of not following in case of a quasi-judicial or a judicial inquiry. Because it is a fundamental right. In any type of a dispute or an inquiry, to have a support of a natural principle of justice is a fundamental right. So in this backdrop, when we come to the civil adjudication, friends, and many times when I go for a lectures on the civil procedure code, the first question before the practicing lawyers is that, oh, it's a huge material. So many things are there in this civil procedure code. How we can conduct all these matters by using so many sections and orders? So many things are there. Yes, definitely. It's a big statute. 158 sections are there. Order 1 to Order 51 containing huge number of rules are there. I have written 3 books. I have not yet counted how many exactly rules are there. Many rules are there. State amendments are there. High court amendments are there. Appendix to the CPC is there. And therefore, when I go for this lecture, I normally ask question, and also I will make this appeal to all my law students, that it is a civil procedure code. C-O-D-E code. The question should ask in the mind of the person who is in legal field, because you have to interpret the law. Why the word code is used? C-O-D-E, code. Why act is not used? Evidence, act. Many other laws, it is an act. But it is code, civil procedure code. Why the code is used? Then, the question is that what is the meaning of the word code, C-O-D-E, code. Many of us are from the Marathi medium. You can go and simply have a dictionary meaning of the word code, and you will find that the simple word used in a Marathi for word code is of a sangraha. Sangraha. Civil procedure code manje वेगवेगळ्या गोष्टींचा तो संग्रह आहे. What is sangraha? It's a collection. If it is an act, it is a single piece of a document. If rules are there, in an act, there is one section which says that the rules can be framed on following subjects, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It is said to be a rule-making power under that particular act. By using that power, different rules are framed. Different rules are the different instruments. They are the separate document then separated from the act. Act is a separate document. Rules are the separate documents. But rules are said to be the wheels of the act. Whatever the substantial provisions in an act are made, in that particular substantial provisions, these rules works like a wheel to take the purpose of the act ahead. Here in a civil procedure code, section 1 to 158 is a substantial provisions of section, and there is schedule 1 attached to these sections by virtue of section 121 of the civil procedure code. And by section 121, the orders from order 1 to 51 as attached to the code. You can take section 121, read it, and you will find that there will be a schedule 1. And whatever the rules are framed, contained in that particular schedule 1 rules will be part and parcel of this code. So it has become a part and parcel. It is a something different. Like other act and rules, it is not an independent document. It is a part and parcel of the civil procedure code. There's also certain formats, appendix. For appendix A gives you how pleadings format should be there. If you are drafting a suit for partition, what minimum word should be there? If you are drafting a suit for recovery of money, what minimum word should be there? Likewise, a different forms are given. If you are replying, you are giving a written statement to the suit, a particular type of a suit, a money lending suit, what types of minimum reply should be there? All these formats are given, and therefore, all these appendix A to H, they are also the part and parcel of the civil procedure code. So there are sections, there are orders, there are appendix. Apart from that, there are various amendments proposed, given by the states in different parts of the CPC. Also, there are high court amendments given to the different parts of the rules for practicing on a civil adjudication. So altogether, it's a civil procedure code, friends. So when we talk about the civil adjudication, the first and most important exercise which the law student must do, if a particular suit comes to you and if a client comes to you, you have to collect a proper factual information from the client. Client is a layman, first of all. The another jurisprudence of the word you can understand. Every individual is against the rule of the law. Principle of jurisprudence I am talking about. Every individual is against the principle of law. If there is a law that there will be only one vehicle and no another two vehicles should be purchased, my own feeling will be that it's all right. For me, there should be at least two vehicles, three vehicles. For others, it's all right. There is a congestion, there's a pollution now, there's a corona, and any time some type of a dangerous epidemic may come, so there should not be a two vehicle. But for me, at least there should be two. My wife is there. She's architect, my son is lawyer, what I can do, at least I should have two vehicles. This is my own mind. So law is appreciated for the entire society other than me. For me, there should not be much law, much obligations of the law. That is a general human psychology, and therefore jurisprudence says that individual is against the rule of the law. This mindset has to be tackled by the lawyer when the client comes to you. And therefore, The art of the cross-examination starts for the lawyer from his own client. His first exercise of a cross-examination, good cross-examination, is with his own client. You have to cross-examine whether your client is truthfully telling you all the facts, whether he's hiding anything. You have to explain him if you are hiding anything. It is not going to hide. It is going to come and crop up at one particular time. And that will be a difficult time for you because you have suppressed now. And that suppression will be affected afterwards to you. By making a proper dialogue, by taking confidence of the client, particularly at a juniorship, at a new advocacy, in a new advocacy, you have to develop this bridge. Once you are very senior and once you sit, many times the half of the work is done by your juniors. Or whenever the client comes and sits, and when even a senior uses a word that karasanga. So many times he talks about the truth. But in a junior times, in a newcomers, they will try to impress you that they are correct by hiding many other things. So you have to see the facts. You have to use your own logic. You have to use your second sense, third sense, fourth sense, fifth sense, whatever sense, up to sixth sense. You have to verify the documents. You have to collect the documents. You have to scrutinize the document. What is 712 extract? What is city survey extract? What are the roads, maps? What are the entries there? Why they are not correlated with the facts given by the client? What is the exactly disorder between them? The reasons for this disorder, everything should be scrutinized. Like a doctor, when a patient comes, doctor examines, then he takes a blood test, then he takes the x-ray, then he makes this investigation, then he makes that investigation. Ultimately, report comes and then he makes a conclusion that this is there, and we have to start this line of action for curing this particular patient. Similarly, taking the facts and immediately starting your work of your own pleadings on that particular aspect is not advisable. You have to be patient. But at the same time, you have to be cautious also that the client should be under impression that you are working on his brief honestly, sincerely, dedicatedly. You can't wait. Go on searching. The client will go to another advocate. Naturally, it's a time that everybody wants speed. And it's only civil adjudication which is hampered for not going for speed. It's a truth. We have to see, at least your young generation has to see. And you have these all modern techniques in your hand. 712 extract, you can go to the government site and see the 712 extract. You can get it. Another records, many records, another factual aspects, if it is a property, if it is a persons, so many details are available. By taking all these efforts, you have to work on that particular brief before making your pleadings. So before pleading, you must be satisfied that correct, unaltered, unsuppressed facts are in your hand. Then you know the law, which law you have to apply, and then you have to start your own pleading. Friends, law. You are a lawyer. Law has been taught to you. That law degree is a paper degree. You want to do a practice. The medical professional also gets a degree. They also go for a practice. There's a difference. You know that. Law degree is not that way effective as of a medical degree. So you have to again work and get experience till you stand on your own legs, because you know academics perhaps, but you don't know the application. In the medicine, whenever there is a academic knowledge given, immediately, if an anatomy, immediately body is shown. Yes, this XYZ, and this is a body. That part is lacking in our profession. We are trying to correct it. It was told that we started a moot trial in an NBT Law College, a national level event now in the last 13 years, because we want to remove the impressions of the law students. That witness, as seen in a movie, doesn't come from the doors in front of the judge, or the lawyer can't shout that, yes, my lord, mere paas ek chashmadeer gawah hai. Nahi hota ye. There is a procedure. There is a CRPC. There is an Evidence Act. Document. Sometimes you see that a document comes from the pocket of the lawyer or a pocket of the clients and directly handed over to the judge. Not possible. That is not a civil adjudication. Permissible. So the attempt of the law colleges is to explain the application, methods of application, along with an academics. So law, academical part, and law, practical aspects, or application of the law, are two different things. Because law academically can be seen on principles. This is a principle of a particular law. When it comes for an application, it cannot be a similar case. Every one case is different than another case. Just remove one particular fact from one case, it will be a different case. And law is to be applied on facts, not on only principles. Principles are the ultimate arguments of the lawyers. It depends on the facts of the matter. Whether that particular principle is applicable to your fact. And therefore, law basic should be known. If you're asking a partition for a daughter, you should understand what is the current position of a daughter, her right, if she is Hindu under the Hindu Succession Act. If you are asking some partition against of a Mohammedan family, you should know what is a Mohammedan law, what is a Sharia chart, how the shares are divided. That should be known to you. So two, pre-filing responsibility. Not only filing, I am saying pleading. Because pleading is not only filing of the suit. Before that also, there is something. So you must take the correct facts. Before that, you should not write a word for your client. You should see the correct law as understood by you in the best possible manner. Before that, you should not write a word for your lawyer. Once these two compliances are done, then you can touch the pen and the paper and start writing for your own client. First, most important advice I want to share, which perhaps the young generation may not feel it relevant, but I want to share with you, that writing a pleading for a client must be in a handwriting of the lawyer for the first time. You may subsequently directly get it typed on the computer. It's a mental process, friends. It's not a mechanical process. Law is an issue of living human beings. Though now it's a time that something is talked about the artificial intelligence. I am sure there cannot be a computer who will cross-examine the party. There cannot be a computer who will write a judgment. It requires a human mind. It requires to understand what the witness is speaking, not only by his mouth, but from his eyes also, and from his body language also. For that, a human mind is required, friends. The judge requires that human mind. The lawyer requires that human mind. Analysis by that human mind for traveling towards the justice and another process, which says that a sense of justice. The human mind must have a sense of justice. You may be intellectual, human mind. You may be full of knowledge, human mind. But if you don't have a sense of justice, the justice will be deprived. Many intellectual judges and lawyers have been seen who are said to be intellectual, most intellectual talent of the law, but they have always traveled or worked for deploying a justice. This is not a purpose. We are here to give a justice. We are here to find out the truth. And in that process of finding of the truth, we have to consider the papers, we have to consider the witnesses, we have to consider the circumstances, we have to consider the need of the society, we have to consider the need of the persons, and then ultimately we have to find out the truthful things, favorable to all these things, and accordingly judgment will come, accordingly lawyers will work. So you are an architect. Once a client comes to you, architect designs, contractor makes a contract. So lawyer is an architect. You have to design your own case. Therefore, for first part of your pleading, your handwriting is important, because it is always told by the old generation of the lawyers that once you write, that is captured in your mind. Because you are thinking, you are writing. Your mind and your body, both exercise is done on that particular subject. And in therefore that particular process, the first pleading must be in writing. What is the first pleading? Suit? Maybe. But before suit, there is a notice. Before notice also, there is some letter. There is some correspondence. If the client comes to you, and thereafter some correspondence is to be made, because you are an architect, now you have to design your own case. You have to cultivate your own adjudication. Then you will do that. You may not give a notice. You have to assess the situation. You will write some letter. The reply will be called. In the name of the client, you will send it. It should look like a formal. If it is a matrimonial matter, if you directly start with the litigation, your mind will be argued to be for litigation only. There was a litigation in your mind that is harmful to you, because the matrimonial relations are not always subjected to the litigation, and solution is not always available in the litigation, friends. So the question is that the notice, the first letter, first correspondence, prior to notice or suit, whatever your first pleading will be there, that is the base for your entire further suit. Once you write and once you commit yourself and your client by some words, some line, some pages, you can't divert yourself from that particular stand taken in that particular pleading. So this is a very important aspect. Write very cautiously. Write very thoughtfully. You write, let your client read. Let your client read, you hear. Give a thought, a line, a word, a full stop, a comma. Everything matters, friends, when the trial stands. And for that particular purpose, sitting before the typist or on a computer, making a best work is the most criminal wrong the lawyer will be doing. Best work for the notice. Yes, computer zala notice takli yela. No, friends. Then it may be possible for some documents you are doing, some satikat, khridikat, is that. There also the facts are different. Try to do your own drafting without going for a best work of a computers. As far as the litigation is concerned, don't do that. Don't sit before the computer with a typist directly. Don't sit before your own computer, your own laptop with some draft before you and making some corrections in that particular draft. Don't do that. If at all you want to type on your own laptop with your own handwriting, make a complete fresh draft. And with that particular draft, you should go further. When you are going for the suit, Order 7 must be seen by the lawyer. Appendix A must be seen by the lawyers. What is the minimum requirements? Which words are minimum required? If you are dealing with a specific relief act, the provisions of the specific relief act where a mandatory provision that you must plead and prove that you are ready and willing to perform your own part of a contract must be written. If you are not writing that, the suit will be thrown away. If you are not following the format given in an appendix A, suit will be hampered, substantially hampered. And it will be a responsibility of the lawyer only. Because the client is layman, he don't know what is the appendix A. He don't know what is specific relief act. He don't know what is a pleading. He don't know what is a format. He don't know what is a verification. He don't know what is a valuation. He don't know what is a cause of action. He don't know what is a limitation. He don't know what court fees is to be paid and how much is to be paid. This is only and only responsibility of the lawyer, advocate. So in this civil adjudication, you shoulder this responsibility, friends. You can't go away from that. If you cause any mistake here, it's a professional wrong. And it's a time that now you are answerable to everybody. There is a serious actions of the professional wrongs, professional misconduct. And therefore, when you are signing on a notice, when you are signing on an complaint, wakalatnama, you are not only getting one brief, but you are sharing the great responsibility, obligation of all these technical legal things there. If certain factual aspect is wrong, you may not be responsible because that's client input which you have incorporated. You must try to find out the correct inputs. If some wrong inputs are given, you must correct it. That is your responsibility. But even if you are not doing that, that is not your professional wrong. But if you are on a technical grounds, making the wrong valuation, calculating wrong limitations, putting in a wrong jurisdictions, not making a proper verifications, not affixing the proper court fee stamps, this will be your own responsibility. Now it's a time when the commercial courts acts are coming. Now it's a time when the speedy civil trial will be set to be the need of the time. Because the speedy relief to the litigant is a fundamental right under Article 21 now. You know that. You can't delay it. So once the brief is handed over, if you are waiting and the limitation is over, you will be professionally prosecuted. You have to be alert. So all these obligations are there in your shoulder when you are doing a civil adjudication, friends. So this starts with a civil adjudication. The same responsibility is on a defendant, his lawyer. A written statement is another counterpart of the pleading. Pleading, Order 6 defines pleading means plaint and written statement. No other part of the suit can be said to be a pleading, except if it is counterclaim and written statement to the counterclaim. Amendment application, it is not a pleading. Exhibit 5 application for interim injunction, it is not a pleading. Any other applications, attachment, receiver, this and that, these are not pleadings. Pleading means only plaint, written statement, counterclaim, and written statement to the counterclaim. This can be only pleadings. The base of entire suit is on this pleading, friends. Then comes the service of the summons. See the sequence of the litigation. You are preparing a plaint. You are filing at a proper jurisdiction. You are with wakalatnama. You are with court fee stamp. You are with the proper parties to that particular litigation as a plaintiff, defendant. Order 1, 2, 3, 4 takes care of all these things. How pleading is to be done? General rules are there in Order 6. How plaint is to be drafted? Provision of Order 7 is guiding you for drafting of the plaint. How written statement is to be drafted? Order 8 guides you. So 6, 7, 8, they are the pleadings. 1, 2, 3, 4 are the suit and filing proceedings. Remains in between. Service of the summons. Suit is filed. Suit summons is to be served. That is Order 5.
You can't take directly summons through any other mode, but it should go only through the court. A bailiff summons, a suit summons, order file. Then you can adopt an alternate modes of the service of summons that can be by register post, by email, courier, etc. Even a WhatsApp is permissible. These are alternate modes. You can't give a bypass to the suit summons through court. That is mandatory. If it fails, then other parts of summons can be accepted. So service of the summons in a particular procedure, the purpose is that there should be a proper service. It should not be a fraudulent, misrepresented service. So the purpose is that, again, by natural principle of justice, the person must be properly served. That is a simple natural principle of justice. So this part, first phase of the suit adjudication, civil adjudication, filing complaint and filing of the written statement. This is a one section, first compartment of the civil adjudication. And in this process, you can see it is comparable again with the natural principle of justice only. It's a simple sequence. See the natural principle of all of justice. If some complaint is filed, if you want to make a complaint against a person of a criminal nature, you must go and file it to the police station. You can't go and file to the collector. But if you want to file some revenue dispute, your name is not mutated properly, you should file before the revenue officers. You can't go and make an application to the police. It's a common sense. Nobody tells us. But it is known to everybody because it's a natural principle. The competent officer, a complaint should be given. The complaint, that to competent officer. Once that competent officer gets that complaint, the another person against whom that complaint is there, he will be called. Notice, another natural principle of service. Once a notice is given, his explanation will be called. So they say that will be filed. Once the say is filed, both parties will be asked to give their own documents or any other evidence. They will be heard and judgment will be given. On these natural principles only, civil procedure, court, and civil adjudication travels. Only some sort of developments of the procedures are there. But they are simple. The logic is same. And therefore, there may be number of provisions in law. Section 9 to 35 sections deals with the civil suit, filing of the plaint, jurisdiction, conducting the suit up to the judgment and decree. And similarly, if you go in an orders also from order 1 to order 20, all these procedures are with a certain particular stage. Plaint is filed, summons is given, plaint defendant appears, defendant files his written statement, further investigations, hearing of the matter, judgment and decree. So friends, this civil adjudication is of this nature. Once in a civil suit, written statement is filed, the basic work of the first part of the party is over. Then it's judge whose role starts. Whether it is a civil trial or whether it is a criminal trial, judge is an ultimate authority over that particular matter. He is the director of the entire game. As in a film, we know there is always Digdarshak, director. That Digdarshak means the judge. He will take all calls. You can have all authorities, but ultimate discretion with him. Who can be a party? Who can be added? Who can be deleted? Whether this is a proper service of summons or not proper service of summons? Whether time is given properly for filing a written statement, in a time it is filed, whether additional time is required, though there is a 90 days time, whether beyond 90 days time can be given, whether his written statement can be taken with cost, without cost, all these authorities are with him. So once order 1 to 9 goes into this plain written statement, appearance of defendant, everything, then order 10 comes, which is an authority of the judge. In that order 10, the judge sees which are the admitted facts and which are the disputed facts in this particular civil suit. Whatever the admitted facts are there, proof is not required. Because simple thing, which is admitted, need not be proved. So the best admission, there are many types of admission. Those who have learned Evidence Act, they knows that there are many types of an admission. The admissions can be conclusive also. The admission can be rebuttable also. But the admission out of a pleading is always said to be a conclusive admission. One particular fact is pleaded in a plaint, and in an interim statement it is admitted. त्याचा माझा सर्टिफिकेटचा करार अमुक अमुक तारखेला झाला आणि त्यांनी मला 2 लाख रुपये दिले. हे बरोबर आहे की सर्टिफिकेट करारनामा झाला आणि त्याचे 2 लाख रुपये मिळाले, ऍडमिटेड. पण अनदर डिस्प्यूट, बट दिस पर्टिक्युलर आस्पेक्ट दॅट या या तारखेला सर्टिफिकेट करार झाला, 2 लाख रुपये दिले, दिस इज ऍडमिटेड फॅक्ट. सो इन दिस मॅटर नाव कोर्ट हॅज टू डू अन ऍडज्युडिकेशन, अँड फॉर दॅट ऍडज्युडिकेशन now both cases are before the court. What is plaintiff contention, what is defendant contentions, both are before the court by plaint and written statement. From this plaint and written statement, which are the basis for the adjudication, court has to find out which is admitted fact, put into an admitted box, which is a disputed fact, put into a disputed fact. Court can make an inquiry further for ascertaining which is a admitted fact, which is a disputed fact. That is up to the court. All that procedure is there in order 10. Court can call the witness, court can call the documents, court can give a notice to the parties, other than parties, everything court can do. And then court will certainly fix 2 boxes. This is an admitted one. Here no evidence is required. This is not admitted one. Evidence will be required. Then the right of an investigation gets to the parties. What is this investigation? You can see order 11, 12, 13, 3 orders are there. If you want some document from another party, opposite party, you can give a notice for inspection, for getting copy, for production of that document. Even if you want some document from a person other than party, you can give that application to the court, explain the court why it is required, explain the relevancy, and thereafter call that document before the court. You can go for interrogatories, a written cross-examination with the permission of the court, that is there. You can give a notice to admit a fact. You can give a notice to admit document. XY document is there, it is filed. Proof is required. But before that, if you give a notice to other opposite party, an opposite party admits that yes, this document I admit, then there is no proof required. It becomes admitted document. So the burden of proof is again gone there. So this is all exercise is available to plaintiff also, defendant also. This exercise is to be done by use of the order 11, 12, 13. We call it as an investigations, interrogatories. Once this is completed, then again court has to give a look towards the dispute and see now there was 2 boxes, admitted and disputed. Undergoing by these investigations, still something from an undisputed, unadmitted is said to be admitted. Take out that particular fact, put into admitted box. So the finally now, for going for the hearing of the matter, which are admitted things and which are disputed things, is before the court. Now the evidence is to be given on a disputed points or disputed facts. These disputed facts are before the now court, and on that disputed facts, court will frame an issues. So framing of the issues is an important thing. Unless and until the issues are framed in all judicial proceedings, there cannot be a finding. Court must raise the question whether plaintiff is entitled for a partition as a daughter under the amended Act of Hindu Succession Act, So evidence will be there. Because this is disputed. One party says no, another party says yes. So it is to be decided. Whether there was a sale and purchase transaction between the parties, court will put that. Whether plaintiff purchaser is ready and willing to perform his part of contract, issues will be framed. An answer will be asked from the parties. So issues are framed and matter is now thrown to the parties to lead the evidence. These are disputed points and now come with a proof. And then question of hearing comes, friends. So we talk about then the evidence. What is evidence? Which principle jurisprudence of evidence will be considered by the courts? This is a civil adjudication. Here, the principle of preponderance of the probability will be considered. What is that preponderance of the probability? Whenever there is a question of Nyaya Devata, you get that tarazu. So there are two tarazus. So some proved facts are put into this tarazu, that tarazu, this tarazu, that tarazu, through hearing process. Arguments are made. And then the Nyaya Devata balance that tarazu. Who is powerful? Who is more reliable? Who is more probable? This assessment is done by the judge. So this assessment is done with the principle preponderance of the probability. So it's a preponderance. Ponderance. One word is ponderance of probability. Ponderance means more effective. Which probability is more effective? The decision will tilt towards that probability. If it is plaintiff's side, suit will be decreed. If it is defendant's side, suit will be dismissed. For that particular purpose, the jurisprudence, which is applicable to the civil adjudication, in all types of civil adjudication, whether it is civil suit, whether it is something before some tribunal, whether it is any other matter, preponderance of the probability will be considered by the judge. Evidence. What is the concept of an evidence? Evidence Act is there. Three things are there in an evidence. Definition of a word evidence is there in Section 3 of the Evidence Act. What is that? Evidence means one, witness. Witness coming before the court, taking oath, Deva Shapat Kharasangil, and then tell something to the court that his testimony is cross-examined by other side by considering his chief examination, first contention, and cross-examination. What is his truthful testimony? Whether he's a reliable person to believe, whether he's speaking truthful things before the court, is to be adjudicated, and on the basis of that, material should be taken as evidence. That is evidence. Oral testimony tested by chief examination and a cross-examination in a witness box is a one number of a thing on which the court will rely. What is to be considered as a evidence? For that purpose, Section 60, 61 of the Evidence Act and all other provisions are there of the Evidence Act. When it is a question of a witness, he can tell to the court two things. First, if he's an eyewitness, his first-hand knowledge. Whatever he has sensed, डोळ्याने काय पाहिलं, कानाने काय ऐकलं, स्पर्शाने काय समजलं, अजून त्याच्या इतर सगळ्या भावना शारीरिक भावनांनी त्याला जे काय समजलं, दॅट ऑल हिज सेन्सेस, दॅट सेन्सेस नॉलेज विच हॅज गेन फ्रॉम ऑल दॅट सेन्सेस इज टू बी एक्सप्लेन टू द कोर्ट, इज टू बी एक्झॅक्टली टोल्ड टू द कोर्ट. समथिंग heard from others, something seen by other and told to you. Hearsay, it is zero value. It is a useless witness. It cannot be relied upon. So his own senses is important. Or otherwise, he can be an expert person. Handwriting is there. He's an expert person. He compares to handwriting and says that my opinion is that this handwriting is of this person or this is not of this person. If he is an electronic expert, he examines some CD and he says that his voice is of this particular person. Or if he can say that this particular recording in this audio video is correct, it is reliable, it's genuine, it's not fabricated one, polluted one, that type of an expert evidence can be taken. So either or the witness, he can be eyewitness, he can be an attesting witness, he can be an expert witness. These types of a category of witnesses are there. In that category, whatever he is telling to the court, that will be incorporated in an evidence after considering his chief examination and a cross-examination. This is a first thing, witness. Second thing is document. Document. Document produced to the court. Whatever is pleaded in a plaint or a written statement, and whatever reference of documents are there in a plaint or written statement, that document must be produced before the court is a rule. Under Order 8, Order 7, under Order 13, in an Evidence Act, there are various rules which will say that a procedure is that once you rely in your pleading for some document, referring some document in your pleading, amuk amuk tarkhela satikat karanama amcha madhe zhalela hota, to satikat karanama tya davya sobat jodla paije. That is a rule of the law. That is a basic rule of the adjudication. So that document will come. Now this document should always come in a primary form. Primary and a secondary. Two types of a document. Primary, original one. What is original? Sale deed is registered. Sale deed is registered. One copy is original. Another copy is certified copy. Original is the original. Certified copy is the secondary. There can be any other Xerox copy. That is more secondary. The evidence is to be laid for a document in a primary form is the rule. Secondary is permissible if primary evidence is not available, not traceable. That too permissible when all efforts to bring a primary evidence has been done by the party before the court. There is a failure, but his efforts are seen by the court, and then subsequently the document is necessary, relevant in that particular aspect. With the leave of the court can permit to bring the secondary on record. So document, first of all, for the purpose of production, must be of a primary nature. If primary is not available by making all the exercises, then secondary leave can be there. This is simply the production of a document. Production of a document is not a proof unless that document is admitted by another party. Once document is produced, it is considered as admissibility of that particular document. It depends on whether it is in an original form. If it is required to be registered, whether it is registered. If not registered, it cannot be admitted in evidence. If it is properly stamped, if it is not properly stamped, it is to be impounded, stamped with penalties to be paid, and then it will be admitted in an evidence. These types of rules are there in an adjudication. So document in a two stage. First, admissibility. It should be admitted in an evidence. Admitted means not proved. Then question of proof comes. A formal proof. If it is sell deed, the seller should come and say that, yes, I have executed this sell deed. I got this money. Property stands transferred from me to another party. The cross-examination will be done. On the basis of that, it will be seen that whether this is a proof document or not proof document. It is said to be a probative value of the document. So document admitted, then proof brought, then court will consider its probative value, whether it is probable that this document was executed, and whatever contentions in this document or contents of these documents are there, they are reliable, true, and I should believe on that contents. These things will be considered, and then the probative value will be assessed by the court. That yes, I will rely on this particular document. So this is another aspect of a document. So evidence, two things important, witness, document. Third, now modern thing, electronic record. There is a CD, there is a mobile, there is some photograph, there is some audio, there is some video, there is some email, there is some another text of tutor, many things are there. The modern dialogues which we are doing now. For that, the electronic record can also be included as an evidence, and it can be produced before the court. But it has to be linked with Section 65A(b) of the Evidence Act. Whenever it is not in an original form and it is in a copy form, suppose some audio has been recorded in a mobile and that has been converted into CD and CD is produced or pen drive is produced, there should be certificate of 65B in a format given in an Evidence Act. Otherwise, it is not admissible. So this is the part. So in this particular aspect, the civil jurisdiction goes on. I hope that a basic aspect of the civil adjudication I have been able to place before you. Certain concept of now proved, disproved, not proved in a civil adjudication remains. But I think that it's a big subject of explaining what is said to be proved, what is said to be disproved, what is said to be not proved, and what are the principles of an Evidence Act. For that purpose, we will take another opportunity to have a dialogue upon the evidence in a civil adjudication. In that particular session, I think we can conclude that. I'll only say that proved means a simple thing. Court should believe that the prudent man will believe on this particular thing, that this particular fact exists. That is a simple logic. Any simple prudent man should believe that this particular fact is in existence, that is said to be a proved fact. And similarly opposed, if the simple prudent man feels that it doesn't exist, this fact doesn't exist, or it is not probable, it is disproved. So this particular aspect requires some detailed discussion. At particular college stage, perhaps the concept of evidence is too early exercise. You have to go and do some practical exercise for that purpose. But at least understanding the civil adjudication is an important aspect to the law student, keeping the logical mind, keeping the procedural mind, keeping that whatever happens in the films, drama, doesn't happen in a court. Yes, something like a movie, like a court, you should see that. They have tried to cover many realistic things in that movie, but nobody has gone to see that movie because it is too practical and too of a true nature, so that there is nothing dramatic. So people have not gone, though the awards have been given, awards after awards has been given to the film. So it is not a film, friends, neither it is drama. It is drama, but based on the procedure, based on the logical mind. And therefore, every time, whether you complete 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, every day, you have to face a new drama in a court. And therefore, this profession never gets bored. So in a lockdown time, whenever you feel bored, try to find out some exercise, some series, some movie, which is really showing you the real nature of the court procedures, and go for that movie, see that movie, and you will find that it's really a fantastic profession
whereby human minds, a truth has been found out. So it's a great scientific work which you are going to do. My all best wishes to all the newcomers in this profession and good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sakshi Phalle, are you there?
8 seconds, sir.
तेजश्री काही क्वेश्चन्स असतील चॅट बॉक्स मध्ये तर पहिले क्वेश्चन्स घेऊ आपण. हँड रेज केलं असेल तर अनम्यूट करून आपण त्यांना बोलायला चान्स देऊ. एक प्रश्न सर अगोदर आला होता, मी विचारत होतो इन्क्वेस्ट आणि इन्क्वेस्ट आणि इन्क्वायरी मध्ये फरक काय असं काहीतरी विचारत होतो त्यांनी.
यस, व्हॉट इज द डिफरन्स बिटवीन इन्क्वेस्ट अँड
इन्क्वेस्ट? म्हणजे ते याच्यामध्ये इन्क्वेस्ट पंचनामा असतो. इन्क्वेस्ट म्हणजे ज्या शरीराचं स्वरूप आहे, जेव्हा एखादी मर्डर केस होते त्यावेळेस इन्क्वेस्ट पंचनामा करतो, त्याच्याबद्दल विचारत आहेत का ते? इन्क्वायरी म्हणजे एनी डिस्प्यूट अराइजेस इट इज टू बी सॉल्व बाय इन्क्वायरी ओनली. ओनली द नेचर ऑफ अ डिस्प्यूट अँड द नेचर ऑफ इन्क्वायरी इज डिसाइडेड अँड इट इज ऑलवेज डिवाइडेड इंटू थ्री इन्क्वायरीज विच आय कंटेम्प्लेटेड as an administrative inquiry, quasi-judicial inquiry, and judicial inquiry.
Hey, Jesse, put the question again.
Sir, there are no more questions right now.
No more questions. On YouTube? Can you find on YouTube?
Yes. There is just one question which drama or film sir was mentioning.
Yes. Ask on that.
Where can we get the 65B certificate for using electronic record as evidence?
65B certificate is to be given by the person from whose device that copy has been made. Suppose I have taken one photograph and Sadbhai sir wants that. So he comes with me and requests me that that photograph is required. So he brings a pen drive. So on a pen drive, we give that copy of that particular photograph. Now I have, it is from my own mobile. So I have to give a certificate that I am a owner of this mobile number, so-and-so, of this company. At this particular time, I have taken this photograph. This photograph has been taken on a printer. This printer belongs to me. It is bearing number so-and-so. And from that printer, I have given a copy thereof to Sri Sadbhai. So this is my certificate, this type of certificate. So certificate is to be given by the person being in charge of the machine in which that material, electronic material, is recorded in an original form. Suppose this entirely mobile is given to the court where I have taken photograph. Certificate is not required. Because it is an original document, just similar to the primary evidence and a secondary evidence. Suppose I have shooted this and this particular shooting is to be used in an evidence. I have given on a pen drive. That pen drive becomes a copy. I have to give a certificate to that particular, along with that copy, this particular pen drive has been taken from my own mobile. I have to certify that. But directly if my mobile is given to the court, then it is not required because it's the original form of the recording. So certificate is to be given by that person from whose machine the copy has been made.
So one more question is there. So nowadays there is delay in making order by the court in civil proceedings. What should be done for that?
Delay in making
order.
No, that is not correct. Delay delay making means the delays are not caused by the courts. Delays are caused by either parties or their lawyers. Courts are always having an obligation to hear the matter. But sometimes, suppose the court doesn't have today time and the next date is given, that cannot be said to be the delay of the court. Of course, for that purpose also, we are agitating that there should be more number of courts. But it is not a fault on the part of court, because court is a human being. So if 40 matters are listed, all 40 matters cannot be heard. Out of that, 20 will be heard. 20 will be adjourned for next day. So that is only a procedural aspect. It cannot be said to be a delay by court.
So compromise decree. Anything,
something like compromise decree.
Compromise decree is appealable or not?
Every decree is appealable. Compromise decree, see, section 23, order 23, rule 3A is there. If a compromise is there, there cannot be a new suit filed on the basis of that compromise. And if compromise is to be challenged on the legality, fraud, etc., then the remedy given under order 23 is that it should be launched before the same court and it should not be challenged in the new suit, or even an appeal should not be filed. So what nature of agitation you want to do against that compromise decree depends. And therefore, if there is something like wrong calculations of the shares under the Succession Act, compromise is making some wrong, still one of the party can go in an appeal. So it depends on the grievance against that compromise decree. Mostly, compromise nowadays is said to be non-challengeable, and at the most, under Order 23, rules, I think 3, one explanation is there which says that you can go to the same court and make that grievance to that particular court.
So one more question is there. Preponderance of probabilities, please explain.
Preponderance of the probability means who is having more correct case, whose proved facts are more correct and probable, or who is more effective in the entire case proceedings, so as to give one judgment. See, in a civil trial, in a civil adjudication, either you have to decide from the side of a plaintiff or you have to decide from the side of a defendant. There cannot be a neutral decision, neither on a plaintiff side, neither on a defendant side. Either suit is to be decreed, either it is to be fully decreed, either it is to be partly decreed, or suit is to be rejected. So for that purpose, court has to make an assessment of two sides. One is of a plaintiff side, another is of a defendant side. For making this decision, court don't has to see a beyond reasonable proof. In a criminal trial, we see the beyond reasonable proof. If a prosecution has to claim for a conviction of an accused, he has to show that there is no now doubt remaining. It's beyond doubt. It's totally complete proof. That we call it as a principle of innocence. As far as the civil trial is concerned, that degree of proof is not required. And therefore, it is some lesser degree than the principle of innocence, which we call as a preponderance of the probability. Therefore, I explained that their word should be understood. The lawyer should always have a habit to understand the words and take the literal meaning of the word. Just I explained that civil procedure code. So what is a code? It is a sangraha. Therefore, the same time, preponderance of the probability. Ponderance means more effective, more prabhavi, jasta prabhavi. Hadiza shabdaza artha hai, ponderance. Probability, shakyata. जो प्रभावी शक्यता कोणती आहे त्या शक्यतेच्या बाजून किंवा ती शक्यता ज्याच्या बाजून आहे त्याच्या बाजून निर्णय करणे, दॅट इज प्रीपॉन्डरन्स ऑफ द प्रोबॅबिलिटी.
Sir, there is one more question. What yes. if the person... Sorry, sir.
Minor yes. persons, the evidence, whether he is the witness. Asa, na prashna. Whether a minor can be a witness. Yes, minor can be a witness. There is no bar for giving a witness. To major asla paije. Asa kai nahi. Minor, sakshidar manun kortamadhe alyanantar. Judge var ek responsibility hai. जजनं त्याला काही प्रश्न स्वतः विचारून ही खात्री करून घेतली पाहिजे की तो मायनॉर सर्वसाधारण परिस्थिती समजू शकतो का, त्याला उत्तर देण्यासाठी योग्य काही भान आहे का, असे प्रश्न उत्तर त्याच्याकडे विचारून मग कोर्ट त्याला साक्षीदार म्हणून वकिलांना प्रश्न विचारायची परवानगी देतात. दिस इज द ओनली प्रोसिजर इनकॉर्पोरेटेड फॉर द विटनेस who is a minor. Otherwise, there is no bar. Minor can be a witness.
So, last one question. What if the person owning the device don't want to expose his or her identity, then how to get 65B certificate?
Then you can't get it. Then that is not an evidence. माझ्याकडे एक document आहे. तुम्हाला ते पाहिजे आहे. मी तो तुम्हाला दिलंच नाही. तर ते तुमचं document होऊ शकत नाही. फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन. या केसमध्ये डॉक्युमेंट मध्ये निदान तुम्हाला एवढी मुभा आहे की तुम्ही कोर्टाला जाऊन अर्ज करू शकता की त्याला नोटीस टू प्रोड्यूस करा. पण ते सर्टिफिकेट, सर्टिफिकेट म्हणजे काय, अल्टिमेटली ही हॅज टू से दॅट येस आय शूट, आय मेड दिस शूट, मी फोटो काढला, मी हे शूटिंग केलं, मी हा ईमेल पाठवला, माझ्या मशीनवरनं पाठवला, माझ्या प्रिंटरवरनं पाठवला, हे त्यांनी सांगायला पाहिजे येस म्हणून. तो जर नाही म्हणत असेल, तो द्यायच्या तयारीत नसेल, तर दॅट एव्हिडन्स इज नॉट ऑफ अ यूज टू यू, देन यू हॅव टू गो टू अदर केस. कारण त्याचा उपयोग नाही. कोर्टाने जरी त्याला समन्स काढला तो म्हणाला नाही बाबा माझ्या फोटोमध्ये नाही काढला, व्हॉट इज अ यूज. वी हॅव टू बी प्रॅक्टिकल. आपण जे काही मिळवतो आहोत त्याचा आपल्याला उपयोग होतोय का हे बघितलं पाहिजे. आणि वकिलानं आपण काय बोलायचं याच्यापेक्षा काय नाही बोलायचं हे शिकलं पाहिजे. कमीत कमी शब्दामध्ये कसं बोललं पाहिजे हे शिकलं पाहिजे.
ठीक आहे, क्वेश्चन आहेत का आणखी? हा आपण सरांचा भरपूर वेळ घेतला. आपण सरांची परमिशन असेल तर घेऊ आपण पुढचे.
घ्या घ्या, पाच दहा मिनिटं घ्या.
Sir, there is one question. If plaintiff cross took place and deponent advocate submit foresees to court, whatever we want that gain from the plaintiff, so we don't want to give cross, is it correct or wrong?
म्हणजे जर त्याला त्यांनी चीफ दिली आणि क्रॉस नाही दिली तर का विचारताय तुम्ही?
येस,
दॅट इज नॉट परमिसेबल, दॅट कॅनॉट बी अन एव्हिडन्स. दॅन उद्या समजा एखाद्याने चीफ एक्झामिनेशन दिली, मॅटर ॲडजन झालं आणि तो आलाच नाही कोर्टासमोर, त्याला नोटीस काढली तरी तो आला नाही, तर ती जी काय त्याची चीफ एक्झामिनेशन आहे इट विल बी डिबार्ड फ्रॉम द एव्हिडन्स. ते काढून टाकण्यात येईल, ते वाचता नाही येणार. त्याच्यामुळे नोबडी कॅन डिनाय दॅट. And therefore, he can be also compelled. Tela udya custody madhe ghun sudha anta yel and teche cross examination karta yel. All that powers are with judge. Korta chi pairi manun shahane ni chadune asa purvi manu ti na?
Yes.
And ata yukti mad zhali liye ki manse korta tale shuva shahane hot nahi. Ashi ata man zhali liye.
Yes, anki kaya question hai?
What is the exact difference between administrative, quasi-judicial and judicial inquiry?
Some next session. It's a long process. So my two lines answer may confuse you. So you can call me at any time and we'll discuss the difference.
Yes, now I request Sakshi Palle to propose vote of thanks. Sakshi.
Yes, sir. And
yes, sir.
Hello. Good afternoon to all. I am the student of NB Thakur Law College. Even I am the newcomer in the law field. in amid of this lockdown period, it was really very essential for all to gear up with the concepts rather than the new concepts, for the lawyers to receive and newcomers to learn. Your today's session have really molded us and helped us to get acquainted with the new concepts and new legal terms. Even it was because of you, sir, that moot court trials held every year in N.B. Thakur Law College gave us a new, gave all the newcomers to many things, and we have learned much more new things. On behalf of new law Guruji web lecture series and N.B. Thakur Law College, I thank you, sir. Thanks for your valuable time which you have given to us, and hope even in future you will guide us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Can you say live streaming off? Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.